So I think I talked to a lot of bands, and some bands are not even in the same like geographical location, and they're emailing stuff back and forth. But I think when you do it your way, like you said, everybody in the room, or at least at some point, it becomes more organic and more immediate, and you can hear that in the final output, I believe.
I think so too. And a big part of that, of the creative process as well, is playing them, rehearsing and live, which obviously we haven't been able to do for the past 2 years basically now. But a lot of the songs on the record, we would test live and see, do people like the song when we play it? So
Right.
having that kind of immediate feedback of, we write a song, get it together, basically have it done. Maybe the production aspect is lacking still, or we got to sort that out. But once the song's done, take it to the studio. Okay, when's our next show? Let's play the song at the show and see what happened.
Right.
Because we were playing so much before the pandemic in New York, just locally, that it was so easy to kind of road test those songs and be like, wow, people freaked out to this one, or maybe this song, people didn't get, or maybe it needs a little higher energy
Tweaking,
things.
right?
Yeah.
What did you guys do during the pandemic then? Were you able to take advantage of the downtime and write like crazy, or did you just lay low?
We've been writing a bunch. It started off a little slow for us because it was such a new thing. It's like now we're all used to now it's like, oh, pandemic, whatever. It's been going on.
Right.
It's weirder that it's gonna be weirder when it's over now.
Right.
But yeah, when it first started, we weren't really writing that much because we had just finished the record. I think I got the master of the record the first few weeks into the pandemic when the lockdowns were really
Oh,
happening.
wow.
So we were kind of like, done and spent on that aspect of it. So we took a few months off, and then once things kind of started settling down after that first initial wave, we started getting back together immediately and writing. And that's the worst thing about the pandemic, is that we were planning to release the record at,
Right.
beginning of 2020 or whenever this started.
Was it hard to sit on it for that long?
Yeah, it's always hard to, when you put so much work into something like that, and then it gets old having to tell people, yeah, we have this really great record and we worked on it. Let me hear it. Oh, sorry, you can't hear
Right.
it. I tried
Right.
telling that to people for a year and a half now, basically. But in the grand scheme of things, the first single, Living Dangerous, is out, and we're gonna have more singles coming out, and eventually the record's gonna be releasing only in a few months. So
So you brought up
so
the
it's happening.
single. That video, again, everything is such top notch here. That video is pretty killer too. I saw that what is it, your manager that has some sort of connections to the film industry? Is that how that worked?
No, that was that we did that video with a friend of ours who we've worked with for a while. Andy Gould does have connections with the film industry, but
Not
we
for
did that.
this.
Yeah, we did that with our buddy and who we've worked with for a while, who works in film and has for a bit, and
It's
he's great.
stunning.
And yeah, it was really fun to shoot. I think it turned out great, and Dorothy was great in it.
That's one of my bullet points too. How did you end up with her? How did she come about?
So she's actually managed by Chris Nielsen, who I mentioned before was the guy that heard Living Dangerous in Chris Lorealge's studio and told
Right.
our label, you guys have to get signed. So there's all these kind of funny intertwining relationships. And our label said, hey, this would, what do you think about a feature? We think that would be really cool if you had a feature on this track. And we said, okay, let's try it. I mean, it was a little weird at first because we've never had a feature. So, as an artist, the song is your baby. So
Right, giving
you
it to
think,
somebody else.
do we want to have someone else ruin our song? But then when we got it back, I was blown away by our performance, and it was great, and it was awesome to meet her and have her on it. And we'll definitely be the single. We ventured into the single world. I sorry, the feature world. So we'll definitely try to have some more people on our songs. It's not so scary anymore.
So that's an interesting thing because, again, like I talk to a lot of bands and there's this, a lot of people going the, I guess the music business is sort of reinventing itself and people are heading towards that one single every 6 weeks or every month or whatever to keep them relevant, as opposed to the old school way, like I'm used to, you know, getting the vinyl or whatever it is and listening to it, you know, sequenced. Are you planning on going that route as well with the singles or the features or that kind of thing?
Yes, I think so. I think we're still taking a pretty traditional route of, you know, we're going to have, you know, three or so singles before the record's right. released. But that's kind of the great thing about, that's one of the upsides about streaming and Apple Music and all that stuff, is that people can have completely not, well, I guess not reinvented, but people can just, you know, do whatever they want in terms of releasing a record. I mean, I know right. some people now release 25 song records and they just release right. all of it at once.
Right.
You know? Or some people do that cool thing where, you know, the whole album is, I don't know if you've ever seen when the album is grayed out on Apple Music and then has that. Yeah. So some people do a thing where it's like the album will be grayed out. You can see all the track listing and the sequence, but then the songs will kind of come in like every week or so.
Okay.
So, you know, we're just trying to see what works. You know, it's our first real release. So, right.
But I think there's an art to the sequencing as well, right? That's sort of getting lost in the mix.
Totally. Well, yeah. Sorry. Okay. Yeah. I see your point. Yeah. Well, there's definitely an art that's being lost to the concept of an album.
Right. Like which song goes where and how the mood of the record.
Yeah. And also the production of the song, like the production of the album, the way the album sounds, you know, albums definitely used to have more of a cohesive sound. Like a band would release album A, it would have this sound to it. Then album B would have, they'd be experimenting with this sound and right. this type of thing, which is definitely lost when people are just releasing single after single and there's not really a thought. And then they kind of compile it almost like, you know, okay, right. we released 10 singles, compile. Yeah, we definitely believe in creating an album that has a presence of its own and has its own thematic elements to it. Definitely.
I mean, I know you got to keep up with the times and you got to sell records and you got to keep your fans engaged. And yeah. kids like my son's age, that's what they want to do. They just want to get the new, you know, Living Dangerous single and then go about their business. But I'm the old school guy that really appreciates, you know, the time you went into sequencing it, putting the artwork together and doing all that stuff.
Well, we definitely put a lot of time into that and definitely put a lot of time into the sequencing. And we all think of the records the future records we were going to do and this record as a record. So when we're writing the music and we're compiling what songs are going where, when we're producing it, we're definitely thinking about, we want this album to be an experience. So the releasing the singles is great for promotional, but definitely that album, listening to it front to back is definitely, there's definitely an arc to it. And there's definitely meaning behind how the songs have been sequenced.
Yeah, absolutely. And it definitely takes time to think about it and where you're going to go with it. So that's great. That's good to hear. Cause I know a lot of people are not doing that. They're just going neat. And I don't know which one's right or wrong. I'm just, you know, set in the ways.
I think it depends on who you are. You know, some people aren't into that. I am. So.
Right. When you're writing, are you writing songs like how they're going to come across on stage in the live setting? Or are you writing songs just for the song's sake and then figuring out how they work out live?
There's a little bit of a combination of both. I personally am under the philosophy of a great song is a great song. And if a song is a great song, it's going to, you know, go over great. Mm-hmm. So when we're talking about kind of the core of the song, not thinking too much about the audience, but definitely once we're starting to get into production and saying, okay, how do we make this big? How do we make this X, Y, and Z? You know, we'll put a drum breakdown or something as we're right here, actually in my home studio, you know, put it just like the MIDI drums, we'll throw a drum breakdown or a guitar breakdown, or everything drops out. And that's when we start to kind of get hints of, oh, this is going to be awesome live. Or then you hear something like that, you think, oh, this is going to be great live. How can we make it even better? So it's kind of just, you know, one of those things where it depends on the song, depends on the situation, but it is definitely a thought that's in our mind, for sure. Okay.
I really dig your stuff too, and it's such a nod back to even in your bio, but you can hear it as well. Your influences to like the Def Leppard production or the Zeppelin thing. Is that your background as well, the guys in the band?
Yeah, it's we're all into that kind of music.
I see the Def Leppard on your wall there.
Yeah, that's my. I have a picture with them and autograph. So that's my little Def Leppard shrine. It's you know, all of us are we like a lot of that old stuff because, you know, if you're a musician, the pinnacle of all that stuff is 60s, 70s, and 80s.
Yes.
You know, if you're a guitar player, it's everyone from, you know, Jeff Beck, you know, Eddie Van Halen, Jimi Hendrix, obviously Randy Rhoads. You know, you're kind of, you're spanning that gap from, you know, 69 to 90 or 69 to 85 of the guitar, the guitar hero generation. Same with drummers and singers. So I feel like if you're really serious about playing an instrument, you always got to look back, you know, to the beginning and who kind of invented, you know,
right.
What's, you know, the status of, you know, this is what a guitar god essence is, you know, and obviously that kind of changes over time, but that's really the starting point of it. So, and then we also love all sorts of music. We just did a cover that's up on YouTube of Kanye West, a new Kanye West song, which is
oh really?
Okay. Yeah, it's a song called Jail. It's up on our YouTube, which is Tempt Band. And so we love all types of music and we get all types of inspiration from everything, but we miss the idea of fun rock. And there seems there seems to be a lack of mainstream fun rock
and
fun
big rock production.
Yeah. And with big production. So, and that used to be what everyone loved was fun rock.
Yes.
Pop 40 was what everything, it was as big as it got. So, you know, we want to take those influences of that style and aesthetic of old and bring it into, you know, bring the style of that into the modern light with modern production, because we think people would love that. Rock is either too soft or too heavy right now. And it doesn't really appeal to that core demographic that.
Yeah. And so I'm working on a side project on a film, but that deals with this sort of same thing. But I think that, in my opinion, that kind of music was an escape from all the stupid shit that we're dealing with now. You don't have to worry about like some of this heavier stuff is complaining and whatever social. This is just fun.
Yeah,
and I think exactly. People need that.
Exactly, and that's why we write the music the way we do. We're not, you know, if we wrote anything else, it wouldn't be genuine because we're not depressed people. You know, we're not living in the worst conditions in the world. We're writing about our time we've had as young people living in New York City and, you know, friends and girlfriends and all that stuff. So, you know, that's, and we believe when I listen to music, I like to listen to music that's an escape like that for me. That's fun. That takes my mind off things. That's energizing. That is inspiring. So naturally, I want to write the same kind of music.
I think you're in the right at the right time frame too, because everybody needs an escape from this nonsense now. So, man, all the best to getting this. This should take off. Like, you've got all the elements. I mean, it's produced amazingly. It sounds great, and it's an escape. I think it's going to do really, really well.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I hope so.
What do you guys got planned live? Are you able to do anything live yet? Or are we still on pause?
We're still on pause. You know, we dipped our toe in a bit, and then, you know, it's been crazy because you see all these reports of, you know, this band's going on tour, and then a week after they go out, it's like, well, now they had to cancel a week of shows.
Everybody,
someone had to. So we're still taking a pause. We're hopefully we're planning on still going over to Europe in the summer and doing a big bunch of festivals there. But
next summer,
coming summer. That was actually planned for summer of 2020, and it's been pushed back 2021, and then now 2022. So, but everyone can find. I'll just do my quick social plug.
Yeah, please.
Everyone can find information on all our social media. It's all either Tempt or Tempt Band. I think Facebook and YouTube are just Tempt, and then Instagram. And all that stuff. We have TikTok now as well. We have some funny TikToks. It's all Tempt Band. So any information about shows, cover, single releases, album release will all be there.
Okay, cool. Did I miss anything you wanted to cover? I think we went through it pretty good.
No, that was great. I'd just say check out the new Kanye West cover we did and the single.
Definitely check out the single. I'm going to go check out the Kanye West one right after we do this. And I guess that's it. I wish you the best of success with this because I really dig it.
Great. Thanks, man.
Have a great, you got a full day of press?
I think I got one more after this, then I'm going to write. So.
Oh, good. So not too bad.
Not too bad.
All right. What's New York like these days? I'm originally from there. Is it terrible?
It's gotten a little bit better. It's still pretty bad though.
Is it?
It's like, yeah, it's just, it's been getting gross here.
Is it really? I've been out for 16 years now, but.
Yeah, once the pandemic happened, it just felt like everyone stopped caring. You know
what really? I mean? Yeah. That's what I've heard. I still have family up there, but I've only been just real quick. I haven't really, you know, hung out in the city.
Yeah, but it's getting a little better. You know, we'll see what happens.
Where do you see, I know I said I'm done, but we got a couple minutes if you don't mind. Where do you see the music business coming out at the end of all this? You think it's going to, I mean, it has to reinvent itself a little, right?
I think, yeah, it definitely has. I mean, we for about a year did just these live stream concerts, which was great, which we probably would have never done without this. I think people are finding a lot of ways to connect with their audience more, whether it's through simple stuff like Twitter or doing some of these live stream type shows.
People are doing like Twitch or something, which I don't even know what it is. It's like video games or something.
Yeah, people do Twitch, which is streaming on video games. Well, it used to be just for video games, and now people actually stream music and stuff on that.
I spoke to Matt Keefe from Trivium just recently, the frontman.
Yeah.
And he actually makes more doing his Twitch stuff than he did like a full record cycle in Trivium.
That wouldn't surprise me.
Twitch, he's turned it into a whole thing.
Yeah, people make a lot of money on Twitch. Because, you know, you can donate, either you can subscribe, which is like paying $5 a month to that person,
right.
You know, for special access and whatnot. So, yeah, definitely a big move to Twitch. But I think the upside is that once things, we're already starting to see this with how many people are trying to go to concerts and stuff, especially in states that, you know, have much looser restrictions. I mean, things are like packed, you know, huge. So I think once, if it ever happens, it seems like it's never going to happen. But once things completely stop with all this COVID nonsense, I think, you know, people are just itching to get out and see a show.
I went and saw it. It wasn't even a rock show. I just saw Sublime and the Dirty Heads recently, the only show I've seen.
Oh, great.
Since the pandemic started. And it was like a normal place that would have been like half full was like, outside, they were standing outside the gates just itching to see live music. It was that crazy.
Yeah, so I'm hopeful that will be the biggest plus will be, and I know that people are really, you know, cooped up and want to go see bands and just live music. So
I know we're running up against time, but what's it going to be like for you to walk out on stage after all this nonsense? You going to be nervous?
I haven't been nervous playing in a long time, but definitely will be anxious. Like I'm already anxious to play, in that feeling of like, I want to go and play now.
Right.
So it's going to be weird. I think it's going to be weird. I might be a little nervous actually. You know, I can't remember the last time I've gone this long without playing a live show.
And as a fan, I can't remember the last time I've gone without seeing a show. I mean, that's a part of life.
So we'll just have to rehearse more than usual, I guess.
But also you got to know that probably you could do anything you wanted on stage and the people there are just dying to see.
They're going to freak out. Yeah.
They're going to freak out anyway. So you're going to get a great response no matter what.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm very excited. You know, we should be playing soon. So again, awesome. Check out all our social media for the details on that.
Sorry to run you right up against the timeline, but it was a good conversation. I thought so.
Oh, it was great. No problem.
Awesome. Thank you. Good luck with the record. We'll talk to you soon, my friend. All right, be well. Stay safe. Bye.
Thank you.